Yeah, thank you. And I have an overview slide about me. My Twitter handle is like my name without the blank. I'm working at an Institute for Atmospheric Science on the Forschungszentrum Jülich. I became some years ago a fellow member of the Python Software Foundation. I'm also a board member of the German Python Software Verband. So, and I have to do something for a living, and this time I have a talk about my work in the Institute. The Institute is doing research on atmospheric processes. I think the most of you, they know how clouds look like from aircraft flights to holiday vacation, something. And there are a lot of processes you look at through a window, you see the atmosphere, but all of this is understood. Otherwise, we would have a minute forecast of weather forecast, which is perfect, but we don't have, so there must be a lot of things done. You may remember a little bit from school, or I don't know, some may be also more interested in this stuff. So we living in the troposphere. This is a region up to mostly 10 kilometers. And there, we have some of this biomass burning or some of the factories, they produce some kind of substances also we can smell. So, and these do also reactions in the atmosphere. And then you have, may know thunderstorms, the lightning, that also produce reactions. And in the atmosphere, there's transport mechanisms. And a lot of this is already understood. But we always find with some calculations that we have their gaps in our knowledge. Then the atmosphere is also, there's the transport from the tropes to the poles. And at the poles, you may know from previous documentation that there is an ozone hole is on at the poles and so on. And above the troposphere, there's another region, it's named stratosphere. And above the stratosphere, there's also another region, and that goes up to 80 kilometers or so. And there is some transport mechanisms which go from the troposphere to the stratosphere. And the aircraft, they usually don't be able to get in this high altitude, which is the stratosphere, but there are also some aircrafts we can hire which can do this. And we do then process studies in this atmosphere. And this is mostly focused because we want to know more about the climate. You have probably seen on Twitter there was a information that there is a big ice splitting up from the Arctic ice. So that's because of global warming, and that's a problem for our next generation. And in the past, our generation already had a problem with the ozone hole. And so you can do your knowledge, it can be based on laboratory studies, so that you can have reactions in a laboratory. And so you know some reactions take some time, and you can then find out which are the substances, and then you need instruments which can measure the substances in the atmosphere. So you can use balloon experiments, aircraft experiments, or also satellite experiments, and all groups doing these experiments, they work together. And with this data, at the moment you know some reactions, some how the flow in the atmosphere is, you can also try to make some simulations, and then you can predict some of the measurements you will do, and if you measure these values, then you know that the prediction was right. Okay, also our most goal is we want to understand more how all these processes in the atmosphere work. This can be very to atomic processes, that there are reactions, that there are transports, how clouds move to some places. And this can be parameterized, and then it just gets into different models. And with all the measurements, you also can help to improve all the models. So then you get better forecast or better forecast for some problems. Maybe if the industry produce more hydrogen, you will also want also to know if that has some effect. And because the problem is how to get to this data. We do this by aircrafts, because it's cheaper to hire an aircraft as to build a satellite. Of course, you can get more data than by the satellite, but you can go to some places now where you need 10 years, or will have 10 years later a satellite, because the procedure to build up this takes very long. But at all, if you hire an aircraft, does that not mean that it's very cheap? It's not like 180 euros to go to Bologna. It's much more expensive. And so the scientific groups in Germany and in Europe, they work together and they hire in collaboration an aircraft. So, and there are various groups, they are specialized in atmospheric research and they build instruments which are automated and they can be added then to such an aircraft. For example, to get in the stratosphere, we can hire a Russian spy aircraft, which was a spy aircraft in the past, and it got an altitude about 20 kilometers, but has a range of 3,000 kilometers. And on this aircraft, you see a lot of slots or bays where instruments can be added, and you can imagine that there are many groups of this aircraft, then they want to use the aircraft and have some scientific goals, and you have to get them all together because everyone paid some money for this aircraft for some weeks. So we can also add to wing ports or to the major base some stuff. That's an example list shortened. It's very long. That's a lot of instruments, group names for substances which can be added to this aircraft. And depending on the mission we can make, then the instruments can be chosen. Another aircraft is for the HALO. It's a Gulfstream. So the difference between the HALO and the Geophysica is that the Geophysica has only one pilot. There's no one on board to manage some of the instruments. And on the HALO, there can be scientists within the instruments and can control them. Another difference is also the range. It can be 10,000 kilometers and up to 15 kilometers. This picture shows one of the bases we use in Kiruna in Sweden. Now you have these groups, you have an aircraft, and now the problems can start because they are from different groups. And you have to manage to get all their ideas together. And you can use model calculations to make some prediction of the atmosphere at the time you may have a flight. So the problem is that usually we always think it's three dimensions, but that's not right. We always have four dimensions. You have always a longitude, latitude. You also have an altitude. And then it's for measurements also the substance of where you are interested in. This has also a value. So for example, in some height, you have an ozone value of this amount. And so you can calculate of the model data an amount of layers which gives you information how it will look like if you fly there. And then if you have put all these ideas in your mind together, you also have the problems that aircrafts cannot fly everywhere. So there's overflight problems, so it's not, there may be a military base you have no idea from because you're a scientist, And then the pilot says, no, I'm not allowed to fly there. So there's a lot of iterations and discussions, which usually could take long time, but this was the reason that these groups have decided to develop different kinds of mission support systems. So this ideas to get together, this started in 2012, and many groups have had the same idea, and the mission support system by Mark Rautenhaus was a successor, because he was able to use, to develop it in the DLR, which was hosting aircrafts, and he was able to design it from the beginning as open source project, and really an open source project it becomes in 2016. And now a lot of groups are working with this software and developing it. And we now have also a feature futurized to Python 3, but it's built for Python 2, and it's a client server application. This software also uses standard, and it's an open geospatial consortium web map service. You may know this from the GIS server. The idea from Mark was we use the same idea as all the mapping servers have. We calculate our data on a map, and then we can use all these tools. This software is also based on Anaconda because it has to run on several platforms, Windows, Linux, Mac, and it's easier to have it instead on your own channel. We are going to ConnorForge. So it's a ConnorForge community application now. License Apache 2 and lots of documentation on RTFD. Mark did also in this, because this idea was so quite good, he did a publication in GMT describing his idea to use a web-based service to plan all these flights. And the principle of this web map service is you have a server with a big amount of terabyte of data, which you have accessed from some cluster or some supercomputer, which can handle this data. And you don't have to transfer the data to the airport where all the discussion with the pilot have to be done. So, and you have a web map service request by a client, then to this server about some region and also some elevation and some substances, and this server makes then an image and sends this back to the client. So you can fast scroll by a client with a very poor network connection to a big amount of data. And you don't have to transfer the data, just only the images to the client. So what we now can have by this, the MSS is at the same time a server and also the client application, so that the data center can install the server component. If someone has other data than already the implemented one, then he can add some methods to it and handle its data. We have now that's a ECMWF data sets for chemical Lagrangian model of Jülich and gravity wave forecast data and some meteosat data and so on. They can be just driven by the server. The client is a Qt 4 or 5 application, which then accesses this server. It can also access other existing servers and overlay or look at these data. And this is just done by an HTTP request. And so that's now the front end for the scientist. And in this front end, the scientist can draw a flight path. And all time he changes the elevation or the layer or the time, forecast time, this flight path stays on top, and he can just focus on the data he has from the predictions, where maybe interesting spots where the aircraft should go. And this flight path is always overlaid on any view. And of course, you can exchange flight paths so that you can have with different groups look at these data. The server has, the architecture is that it is a WSKI application, and it's based on this standard, and you have to give data driver to read your data, and also visualization methods, so for horizontal or vertical views. So that's what the server then delivers to the client. The client has currently major views. It's about a top view and a side view for the vertical stuff. And also it has a table with then all the flight track waypoints, which also can be described or by add-ons added then different other flight patterns. There are some instruments they want to have a hexagon flight pattern and so that can be added there. And all views work together and give then the flight track as a result. Installation is quite easy as it is a CondorForge application. You have to edit the CondorForge channel if you don't have. Create an environment, activate it, install it from Condor, and we have all the server data implemented so that you can set up a local host demo data server so we can check out how this at all works. And on the right side, you see the starter launcher of the Qt application, and on the bottom, how the WSKI server standalone runs. There are a lot of configurations done which could be overwritten by a JSON file. For example, you can enter different map projections or also write your own import and export plugins. Or if you have a very, very slow network connection, you can add a local block proxy and which caches then all these files. The top view looks like this. This shows the blue line here. This is a flight path, also added with some description. And you have the usual interfaces of Matplotlib, where you can zoom or pan inside. You have the possibility to change layers. There's an auto-update feature. Also, keystrokes are supported if you use the arrow keys and or the enter keys and something you have not to use all times mouse. So this is a view just on the map. If you have this flight path then on side view, you can also by mouse move the points in altitude and look at the table, or if you have data about fuel consumption of the aircraft, you can also at performance data of the aircraft, so you know about the range the aircraft can do. And if you look this up with data, you can always see for different kind of species in the vertical view, this is above, how which region the aircraft will pass of predicted data. And then this gives the information for which instruments this may be become interesting. And on the, this is the top view, so you see some, this is a map, this looks like a bit like a weather forecast map you may know from TV. So, and you can also have also the flight path there, you see which region are then overflight. The thing also has add-ons. For example, if you want to compare with satellites, you should have overpass of a satellite where you measure, so you can add the satellite track. Then there's also for some remote sensing an add-on, and one of the newer features is a KML overlay sometimes it's interesting to know where are the borders or where some spots you have to go, and then you can access by KML. This shows an example. If we did a flight from Kiruna to Oberpfaffenhofen. This is on the left side. It's a substance which is used for analysis. It's N2O, and there are some regions where this substance changes. They are passed by the aircraft, and the pilot has added all these waypoints. The pilot has to pass some waypoints which are signals for him. And on this side, on the right side, you have the ozone mixing ratio. That also shows just would pass in this region if we fly this way. And in the vertical views, you see that's all model data, what kind of structure or what kind of changes in the atmosphere the aircraft will pass, and where some data will be sampled. There's a lot of campaigns. Campaigns means that there are groups hiring an aircraft and will together at some places. Then in 2014, this is in the past, of course. There was some from Oberpfaffenhofen. Then 2016 was Polstrak. It was from Kiruna. Then actually, there's this Tretoklim campaign. That's a new project which is just started from Nepal. So this Russian aircraft will be in Nepal, and this will fly over India. And so then it's also Nordex was in Iceland. Emerge is currently running. It's in Europe and Asia. And the WISE campaign will be in Ireland. So there are many more groups which will use this software to plan their flights. We have documentation on RTFD, also these papers. We have a repository on Bitbucket. There is also the main development done. Also that I'm now on Forschungszentrum did not change that it's an open source software. I was agreeing to maintain this software because it became open source, so we don't have the issue that some other company now did the same as have problems maybe with open source. So it is open source, it can't be changed. All we live in an ecosystem, I want to mention this too. We can do such great softwares because others also make great software, and they are also free for us. It's a Bitbucket, GitHub, PyCharm, Quantified Code, which unfortunately will be closed in July, PyTest, PyP, Anaconda, the good, great Conda Forge community, a lot of tools, Jenkins, Travis, Avayo, CircleCI, and of course, read the docs. Without these tools, our ecosystem would not be so great, and we won't have so great tools. So that's my last slide about the mission support system. We are also added to OpenHub, so we have some more analysis. The last release is below 20,000 lines of code, and mostly done in Python, and we have an active contributor rate about 8. Thank you.
So, thank you very much, Raimar. Questions?
Oh, yeah, now it's working. Anyone, any questions for Raimar?
Okay, so thank you very much for your talk. This is not a question directly related to the talk, but are you aware that there is flight planning software also for Sophia, which is the big 747 aircraft that is used for space missions? And have you had any contact with these people?
Yeah, your question was, there are other flight planning software? Well, I don't know if I understand that right. Sophia?
Yes, there's an aircraft called Sophia, which is like a telescope built into an aircraft. They do space missions, but I was once at a talk where they had also like very specific flight time problems. So just a question if you're aware of
that. No. Also, we use these conferences and also other documentation and also campaigns to spread the word that this software is free. We like to have contributors and we like to have it extended. So also it's a task to you. If you know those people, tell about the software and we're happy if there are more contributors and it gets a bigger scope.
Okay, another question? So, over here.
I was just wondering, in the beginning you said that researchers rent this airplane, right? But from whom they actually rent it?
Render?
Eh? Sorry?
No, I don't understand.
Ah.
Yes, that's the MBB, it's hosting the Russian aircraft, and it can be rented there for science. And the HALO is based on the DLR, and you can also rent it there. And there are many others. The DLR also has a Falcon aircraft, and there's another company for Enviscope, which has also some access to aircrafts. But you have to find a company which gives you access to the aircraft. We are not able to get military aircrafts, like drones or something like this.
Okay, so please go to the app and rate the talk or give constructive feedback. Thank you very much, Reimer Bauer.